Hello, my name is Alan Sanvictores, your current Chief of Police for the Monrovia Police Department. In 2017, under the direction of retired Chief of Police Jim Hunt, we created a video aimed at providing the community a better understanding of your police department and what it takes to become a Monrovia police officer. The video was created in response to various national incidents that caused a growing distrust for law enforcement in many communities across the nation. The Monrovia Police Department recognizes the vital importance of finding a way to reach out and serve our community. We hope you enjoy this video.
This film was created to reach out to you, our community members here in Monrovia. Knowledge that will help you form your own opinions about law enforcement, specifically about police personnel that serve you here in Monrovia. How do we find qualified individuals to serve this community as police officers? What is our hiring process?
One of the key roles that I play as Chief of Police is to hire the best people that I can find to serve you here in the community. It takes us 300 applicants to find one individual that can qualify to do the job here in Monrovia. It's incredibly difficult to become a police officer. We're asking young men and women to make oftentimes life and death decisions. The applicant must first fill out a large application, which is reviewed to see that they meet the criteria. Once they've passed the written test, they have to go through a physical agility course. It's a demanding course that requires them to go over a number of obstacles to indicate that they're physically capable of the job. Once they get through that process, they're invited to take an oral exam. If they're successful in the oral interview process, then we put them through a background process. We review everything about their work history, and we'll go out and talk to their former employees, their former coworkers. We talk to their family members, we talk to their neighbors to find out everything about them personally and to determine if they have the correct character traits and the ability to perform the job as a police officer. We put them through a polygraph exam. If they're successful through that process, then they go through a medical exam and a psychological exam. If they're successful with the chief's oral interview and we feel they're a good fit for our city, then we'll give them a job offer. And that just begins the process. There's a conception that police officers don't receive adequate training to do the complicated job they're tasked with. Before we describe the extensive training every officer receives before they ever spend one day in the field serving you, you should know that most of our employees come to us with advanced degrees, military experience, and extensive job experience. Before I was hired by the Monrovia Police Department, I had a bachelor's degree and had owned and operated a small business for 10 years. And my experience is not unique. Over 55% of our staff have advanced degrees. 20% of them have military experience. And all of them came to us with extensive job experience prior to getting hired. An example of one new officer that we recently hired, who was only 23 when we hired him, he came to us with a bachelor's degree and 5 years experience working in a police department. Let us now share with you the one full year of training that each officer receives before they spend one day in the field serving you on their own. They begin by sending them to a police academy. They have to go through an intense training, both in lecture and written exams for academic studies, because they have to learn and understand every law. Every day they go through an hour or more of physical training. They also go through a whole battery of training for use of force techniques. They also receive training in firearms use. They go through multiple week training for driving that's put on by the LA County Sheriff's Academy, where they are put through the paces driving a vehicle at high speeds and also in adverse conditions. Much of the training is very much like military boot camp. They've got folks teaching them discipline and marching and yelling at them. And part of the purpose of that is for them to be able to think and remain calm and not get emotional, so that they can make good decisions in stressful situations. A big portion of a police officer's job is writing, so there's a number of writing assignments that they have to complete to show that they're capable of documenting what would be required for a criminal report. So this entire process is a 6-month process. It's standardized in the state of California. It's very rigorous. Once they get out of the academy, they're sworn in as a law enforcement officer in the state of California, and they come back to us to begin their field training. Our particular training program has 6 phases, and each phase they get progressively more responsibility. So they're assigned to a field training officer who's an experienced officer. The first week, they'll just ride pretty much as an observer. The next phase, they're more of a partner officer where they're sharing some of the responsibilities. The field training officer is observing what they're doing, helping them work on their own. And the very final phase is 2 weeks of what they call a ghost ride, where it's basically officer who's about to go out in the field on their own is out in a car by themselves, and the field training officer follows them to every call and observes them and assists them if they need any. If they pass that entire field training program over a course of 6 months, then they are now able to go out and work as a police officer in the field. From the time we hire someone to the time they actually work a day on their own is literally a year and a half process.
What do we do to continually train our officers to make better decisions in the field?
Training never ends for a police officer.
I've been so many trainings in regards to interpersonal communications. It's so important.
I was a field training officer. I'm learning a lot, and it's amazing.
Having the training that I've gotten helped me out a lot.
I was lucky that I had been trained. Otherwise, that second bullet would have hit me also.
We certainly don't stop with basic training or field training. We have officers that are experts in identifying people that are under the influence of drugs. And so they go through hundreds of hours of training to recognize that and be able to testify in court as experts on that subject and help prosecute and arrest individuals that drive under the influence. Which is one of the great dangers to our community and results tragically in loss of life throughout our state. We've got a number of officers that work in assignments that work gang enforcement in our community. And so they receive advanced training in identifying gang members, different ways to deal with those individuals, the types of crimes they commit, and the laws that pertain to the prosecution of gang members, particularly enhancements for crimes that are committed in furtherance of the gang. Every detective that we have receives specialized training in their area of expertise, whether it's fraud crimes or crimes against persons or auto theft. Each of those officers, when they take on that assignment, receive advanced training to become experts in that field. We have an entire community policing bureau that receives specialized training to help folks get out of circumstances that they're in and better their lives. We do a number of things to make sure that they're aware of the different issues caused by diversity. And one of the interesting training programs that we send every officer to is we send them to a course put on by the Museum of Tolerance in Los Angeles. It's a tremendous course that's certified once again by the state of California for police officer standards and training. And it opens their eyes to the diversity in our communities and the various perspectives that are there to help them make better decisions and have empathy for the folks that they serve. One of the things that we've done here at the Monrovia Police Department is invest in training all of our officers how to deal with the mentally ill. And we don't just send them to one course. We've put every one of our officers through multiple courses on dealing with the mentally ill and to provide them the best foundation to help resolve those issues well. The key areas that we're working on to provide advanced training in the area of tactical communication is to literally provide a tool that could be used nationally for everyone to train their officers to better deal with volatile situations verbally.
Utilizing Monrovia Police Department's new Virtucom training simulator, officers are given the opportunity to engage in tactical communications training like never before. This simulation allows the officer to interact with the subject through a series of pre-recorded video scenarios that change depending on the officer's comments and interaction strategy.
When I went to the academy 20 years ago, there was no form of communication training. You truly learned how to communicate while on the job. Things have changed. Today, there are mandated trainings, and the state has taken a different tone. At Monrovia PD, we know the importance of effective communication. We've sent 4 officers to become instructors on tactical communication skills. Officers stand in front of a screen in a controlled environment where they're able to watch a scenario that would typically unfold in the living room of someone's home or at the car door of someone's vehicle during a traffic stop. But in this controlled environment, the officer is able to work on their communication skills while speaking to a screen. Each scenario has over 50 options as to which direction the call will unfold. Those options come into play based upon what the officer says. It can go very smoothly if the officer says all of the right things, or it can go terribly if the officer says the wrong thing. The goal is if it's going to go bad, we want it to go bad in a controlled environment. Then we want one of our instructors to be able to instruct that officer on what they did wrong, how to improve it, and what to say correctly.
Ma'am, Lieutenant Harvey, Monrovia Police Department. Can I talk to you for a second?
No. I have to leave now. I must leave.
Okay, hey, before you leave, let's talk for just a second. Where do you have to go? What's going on? You feel okay?
They tell you to come here and find me.
Who's they, ma'am? Ma'am, who's they? Ma'am, do you take any pills? Have you taken any pills today?
No, I don't take pills. They're poison. They take my special powers away.
Okay, no pills. How about medications? Do you take any medications?
Medication? I can't remember what it's called. It's maybe like something that sounds like Abilify, because do you have any?
Okay. Maybe your doctor would be at a hospital I can take you to. Would you like to go to a hospital where we can maybe see a doctor that gets you your medicines?
I'll go with you to the hospital. They always feed me there, and they're always nice to me.
We had this once had a situation where subject was inside his house with his family. He threatened his family with a knife, stating that, you know, he was going to hurt somebody. We responded, and I ended up telling him in a joking way, just like, hey, listen, do you really want us to all, you know, end up having to call the SWAT team, come over here, and they're going to go in there and mess up your mom's house? You don't want to do that for your mom. So the best thing, just come outside and talk to us, and I'll get you the help. And after he says, are you sure you're not going to hurt me? I'm like, no, I'm positive I'm not going to hurt you, and we don't want to go make this bigger than it is. Right now, it's what you did. It's not a crime. You know, you obviously need some mental help, and we'll be able to provide that for you if you're able to just step out. And the guy just voluntarily just came out. It was just words that I used for him to come outside and just kind of relate to him.
There was an incident, a domestic violence incident between a husband and wife, Hispanic family. And from my experience in the Hispanic culture, when something like that happens, a domestic violence issue, the female is very reluctant to come forward and to admit that there's something going on, because now she's left to provide for her family. The wife said that this is obviously not the first time it's happened. She doesn't know what to do. And I pretty much just had a heart-to-heart with the wife saying, look, you have 3 little kids. I understand that he's the sole provider, that he's the only one working, but now you have to make a decision. It's not just affecting you. It's affecting your entire family. You have 3 little kids that are looking up to you, that are their role model. I didn't know if she was gonna take that to heart or it was gonna go in one ear out the other, but it's a sincere, it was something sincere that came from me. And, you know, I was hoping that maybe it would sink in. Probably about a year later, I was on a different call, She recognized me. She said, "Officer Gutierrez, Officer Gutierrez, do you remember me?" And I said, "Yeah, I do. How are you doing? How are your kids?" And she said, "I'm great." She goes, "I just want to let you know that I left my husband. It was a very unhealthy situation for me for many years, but I finally, that day was the eye-opener for me and for my kids. I'm working, my kids are doing great, they're doing well in school, and I just want to say thank you very much because what you told me actually finally it sunk in and it hit home. She's no longer in an abusive home. Her kids don't have to see the abuse, and she's well, so."
Some situations require a greater use of force to find resolution. Applying the correct level of force is a major source of training for police officers. The Firearms Training Simulator allows a trainee to respond both verbally and with various forms of force to potential threats in an interactive and changing environment.
I swear to God,
sir, drop the hammer! Sir, drop the hammer!
This is not concerning!
Sir, drop the hammer!
Drop the hammer, sir! Drop it! Put your hands up! On your knees!
Putting themselves in the officer's boots, members of the community are given opportunity to experience the difficult decisions officers must make every day.
It was really scary to me that, especially once when I had the gun and shot, and then I was told that he was dead. And I thought, oh my God, I took another person's life. But at the same time, as I'm thinking that, then I know for a fact that there was two that he had taken.
Please. No, man, leave us alone.
Put down the gun.
No, I wasn't gonna jump, we didn't do anything.
You know, you see the barrel come out, and the first thing you think, okay, is it an adult? Then you see a kid come out, so it is very confusing.
Yeah.
I never think that law enforcement wants to use force. Nobody wants to use force, so everybody wants to go home and have everybody go home. And I think it just reinforces my feeling that I don't want to be in law enforcement, I don't want to make those decisions. And somebody that has to make those decisions is doing it under duress. And I feel bad for everybody when they're put in that situation.
If they're not an easy decision to make, I mean, these are people's lives that you're dealing with, so it's not, it's not TV time. It's actually you're actually trying to figure out how to de-escalate something as opposed to how to contain something and de-escalate it if you can.
Hi, Bob. Bob, you need to stop that, Bob. Hey, put that stick down, Bob.
I mean, it's definitely feels like real life. I mean, obviously, real life will be different because you are in the moment, but. I can see it being very beneficial for training officers.
What I felt, it's like me or them, and you have to be trained. And I can see that just by the way I'm aiming the gun, and how high I'm holding it, and how many times I missed. You need to be trained to fire a weapon.
It was a nice, clear day. Was on patrol, got a couple of calls regarding Bank of America being robbed. I arrived on scene, and when I arrived, I saw that there was a male and a female standing next to each other. He was pointing a handgun at the female's waist, holding her hostage. I resorted on my training and then walked towards him, pointing my gun, yelling at him, telling him, put the gun down, put the gun down. And as I moved forward, he moved back. I had no cover. If he was to turn the gun on me, he would end up hitting me. At that time, I wasn't thinking about my life. I was thinking about her life. I didn't want him to shoot her. He didn't have anywhere to go. So happens that he turned the gun on him, shooting himself in front of me, and the female running away. After the whole shooting, I kind of thought about it, and it kind of bothered me that someone had taken their life in front of me and I couldn't do anything to stop them. After a while, it just, you play it and you keep on thinking, okay, how could I have prevented him from losing his life? We're trained to go towards the danger, and that's what I resorted to. You really don't think about your life at the time until everything is done. He could have shot me. I had nowhere to go. I couldn't shoot back because he's holding an innocent person. You don't think about that when all that stuff's going on. You just think about, how can I save this person's life?
Officer Pacheco saw this suspicious male walking down a dark street. As soon as he asked him to stop and talk to him, the guy ran. And that's when I started driving down to the area of Mayflower and Duarte. We had him contained inside of this block. I was watching all of Duarte Road, east and west, and I was watching the condominium complexes in front of me. He was somewhere in here. As I'm looking back and forth, I could see officers down at the other end of the block that way. I could see officers at the end of the block that way. It's a huge area to search. When I saw him walking toward me down this driveway, he was showing me his hands, extending his fingers out. As I'm yelling at him to stop, 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 he turned away from me and started walking away, which told me, this guy's not gonna stop, he's about to run. So I started to put my gun away as I walked toward him to run up and grab him, and he stopped, and he turned and he looked at me. And just as he turned and looked at me directly in the eye, his hand came up. And as soon as he pointed at my face, I saw flames coming out of his hand. And I knew instantly, this guy is shooting at me. I was shot in the face. The bullet went into my chin, ricocheted down, exited out of my neck, the scar is still there, and then re-entered above my collarbone and is still lodged in my shoulder. My hand came up and I started firing back as I moved to the left. I could have continued shooting as he jumped over that wall, but I also knew I had partners down there at that intersection and I could not keep shooting in that direction. I was lucky that I had been trained to move to the side and I didn't scream out and fall down on the ground. Instead, I had grabbed my radio and told them what had happened and that he's running directly toward you. And when we found him, just over that wall, there's a sloping driveway. We found him laying down in that driveway. He was still alive and we gave him medical care until the ambulance came. I knew I had been shot, but I still had to be the supervisor of this incident. We found out that he had been a serial rapist and was convicted of raping over 51 women back in the 70s. So most likely he was going to wait for a young woman to get home from work at 2 in the morning. He'll be in a prison the rest of his life. We don't want this kind of person out on our streets, raping women and killing police officers. Once I was in the ambulance, I thought, this could be it for me.
The Monrovia Police Department does not investigate their own officer-involved shootings. Like most police departments in Los Angeles County, MPD has an agreement with the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department to independently investigate all officer-involved shootings. Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department investigators respond to the scene, and they take over the crime scene and the investigation. They conduct witness, officer, and suspect interviews, and they also collect and process all of the evidence. They also conduct all follow-up investigation and prepare the case to present to the district attorney for prosecution, if necessary. MPD also has an agreement with the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office. The DA's office sends a team of investigators to the scene of the officer-involved shooting to assess what crimes may have been committed and what information will be needed to prosecute any suspects who may have committed a crime. If there are any questions about whether or not the officer-involved shooting was justified on the part of the officer, both the Sheriff's Department and the DA's investigators will investigate the facts of the case and determine if they believe a crime was committed by the officer. The facts, evidence, and witness statements from the investigation are used to determine if there is enough probable cause to prosecute the officer if he or she has committed a crime. It is the DA's job to determine if there is enough evidence to prosecute.
I hope this film has provided you with information that you were not aware of before. I hope it has given you a look at your police department from a different perspective. Our hope is that you have obtained information that can help you form your own opinion about law enforcement, that you've gained some insight into the caliber of people we hire to serve you here in Monrovia, and the training they receive to help them make good decisions in the field. training aimed at resolving difficult situations with as little use of force as possible. Our officers are community members just like you. They come from varied backgrounds and bring their life experiences to help them on the job. They are fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, sons, and daughters. They have chosen this profession to hopefully make a difference in this community. Our commitment to the community we serve is to uphold our oath of office and to serve with integrity. We know that our officers are human beings, and human beings sometimes lose their way or make mistakes. We will not tolerate those in our profession that do not uphold their oath. We are not naive, and we know that officers sometimes violate policy or law, and we are committed to removing anyone who violates their oath from this profession. We have done this in the past. Those that violate policy are disciplined up to and including termination, and those that violate the law are prosecuted. What we hope to get from you is the understanding that police work is a dangerous job and officers must make split-second decisions on the use of force to protect themselves or others. Those decisions are difficult and challenging. If one of our officers were to be involved in a use of force, we would hope that you would now understand the complexities of the job and the training they have had to help make those decisions.
I hope you have found this video informative. By reaching out and educating our community on the roles and responsibilities of a law enforcement officer, as well as listening to our community's concerns, the Monrovia Police Department aims to establish a stronger partnership with the people we serve. If you have any questions or comments, please call the Monrovia Police Department at area code 626-256-8000 and ask for the Community Policing Bureau. Thank you for your time, support, and for helping make Monrovia a premier place to live.